Welcome everyone. Welcome to yet another session of School Synergy Workshop Series 2021. I am Ruchi Kumar, an assistant professor in Center for Excellence in Teacher Education, and we have been hosting these School Synergy Workshop Series since last year, August 2020. Even before that, we were doing face-to-face workshops with teachers, but ever since pandemic we have been doing this online workshop series, and we are very happy to have you all here after a long gap of 1 month. We were almost for 1 month we were taking a break, and now we are back with yet another session for School Synergy Workshop. So today I have with me Dr. Anju, who is going to talk about multisensory learning, which can be joyful, which can help in self-awareness and for well-being of oneself. And in time of crisis, in time of this pandemic, I'm sure this kind of engagement is very useful for all of us who are working with students. The objective of the School Synergy Workshop series is to provide a platform where both university teacher educators, researchers, as well as teachers who are working in schools can have a common discussion about issues and ideas which are relevant to school education, which are relevant to addressing students' learning. And for this, we have focused on ideas which can be directly implemented in practice, sharing of experience from one's own practice, and ways to convert the theoretical ideas into practice itself. Going forward, we would really like to hear from all of you if you ever implement any of the ideas that we have shared in School Synergy Workshop series. We also have a Telegram group in which we have discussions after the session. We have discussion after the sessions for whatever was the topic for the particular session, using some sort of prompts or some sort of questions. So it is, if people are interested, they can join this Telegram group, and we will be happy to have you there. So now I ask my student, Shalini Soni, who has been doing MA education in our Center for Excellence in Teacher Education, to introduce.
So before we begin this session, let me introduce the special guest we have today, Dr. Anshu. She has more than 25 years of learning experience as well as teaching, and she has conducted various workshops with the teachers and parents in our country. She is the founder of Mahatma Gandhi International School at Ahmedabad. It's a alternative school which for KN-12. She has created the generated resource learning pedagogy, where children learn using everyday space and objects, their body, their senses, emotions, through metacognition. She has scripted and presented nearly 20 films on education, and authored Clay Cures, a book on alternative medicine and parenting things in modern times. Currently, she is completing her doctorate in education at King's College, London. She talks about the use of different senses, including intuition, as the new wealth in education. Thank you, Dr. Anshu, for accepting our invitation. I hope we will have a joyful and engaging learning with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shalini, and thank you, Ruchi, for inviting me. I'm quite excited to be here with this group of students and educators, and I know they're all from different parts of the world. I've packed a lot of things inside today's presentation, and I hope to be able to do justice. The first thing is, well, my surname happens to be Shazo, and I know everybody carefully navigates around it because it's difficult to pronounce. So it's just my husband's is French, and therefore the T is silent, but otherwise it doesn't really matter. The other thing is that, yes, I have completed my doctorate in education last year, but that's okay. That also doesn't matter, but just a small clarification. Let me start with a very small starter activity with everybody. So those of you can come online on screen just for a few seconds. It would be nice. If you don't want to, that's okay too. So let's just start by a small activity starter, which is from Kriya Yoga. And Kriya Yoga, this is a nice one where you start tapping. So essentially you're tapping different parts of your body. And when you tap, you're giving the affirmation, wake up, my cells, wake up. So just start tapping gently everywhere. Wake up, my cells, wake up. Wake up, my cells, wake up. Wake up, my cells, awaken, my cells, awaken. Awaken, my cells, awaken. And tapping all different parts of your body. And if you can stand up like this, and then you can just continue to tap, okay, all different parts of your leg. And just a very quick march. I'm awake and ready. I'm awake and ready. I'm awake and ready. I need to say this. I'm awake and ready. I'm awake and ready. That's right. And that's a fun thing to do. So basically what happens is that this is a nice starter, but believe it or not, it's from yoga, Kriya Yoga, from Paramahansa Yogananda's Kriya Yoga things. It does, by tapping different parts of your body, you're connecting, you're bringing your awareness back to your body. By tapping different parts, you're also releasing the energy blockages. So by saying I'm awake and ready, you're also affirming something that I am awake and ready for whatever has to come. So welcome everyone. I hope everybody's awake and ready. I would like to start first of all by trying to take you back to your childhood and to ask you, if I were to tell you to make a scenery, okay, a scenery. So put your finger in the air and you're going to draw in the air a scenery, just a scenery very quickly. The first scenery that comes to your mind, okay, the first scenery. So let's see, and I can see the scenery that's coming. I can see familiar shapes. All right, well done. And if I'm not wrong, your scenery is something like this. Am I right? Or am I right? Yes. So mostly, I would say more than 90%, I'm playing it more than 90%, people would draw the mountains, the river, the hut, the tree, and the little birds on the top, okay? And this is a question I've asked people from all over the country, from north to south, east to west, whatever. And across generations, and they all draw the scenery in the same way. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is simply an example of conditioning, not education. So a population, a nation as diverse as ours, population has such a large variety of people, such a large diversity. We are all drawing the same scenery that shows something about the nature of learning in our classrooms. And that's my starting point for today. So today, let me begin with my presentation that I prepared for you, since we don't have too much of time. So here it goes. And I hope you'll all be able to. I hope this is clear. So the school that I have founded in Ahmedabad in Gujarat is called Mahatma Gandhi International School. And what you see here is written below is Know Thyself. And the Know Thyself is an important part for me, because the purpose of education is really to help children discover themselves. Who are you and why are you here? As I begin today's presentation, any presentation, in fact, that I made across the country or across even the world, I begin always on a very, very important personal note, because for me, professional and my personal life are actually one and the same. This is a photograph of my daughter, Tara. Tara is mine and my husband Pascal's daughter, and she's no longer in this physical world. She left us in 2014. And after she left this physical dimension, we began to discover a lot of poetry that she had written. And one of the poems that I'm presenting to you all today is this one called Who Am I? And this, she must have written this when she was 9 or 10 years old. And she writes this: Who am I? Am I human? Am I an animal? Or just a soul? Or just a body? But though I now lie in this bed, one day I will be on my own feet running and all of my dreams will come true. But I still have to find who I am. So before we can actually begin to even realize our dreams, we have to find out who we are. And this who am I is a universal quest of human beings all through the centuries. There is no point doing 14 years of school education if it doesn't have, or even college education, if it doesn't answer this basic question, who am I and why am I here? And because these questions are not answered, we have existential crises later on between in people at the age of 40 or 50 or whatever. As a parent, I have withstood that storm of grief because I had my purpose in life, and that was precisely what I'm doing right now. I'm very much in my purpose, and that's why I'm able to be resilient enough to face the storms of life. Now, let me take you now to the big question, first of all. As we talk about education, what are the paradigms that we've inherited? What are the models of education? And as you all know, I'm sure, our current model of education is coming from the Industrial Revolution. And also the prison model. And if you've read Michel Foucault, a French writer, who compares the three, four institutions, he compares the army, the hospitals, the jails, and the schools. And in all the four, he finds the same things. You know, the monitor system comes from jail, the uniforms come from jail, the roll calls come from jail, the assembly session comes from jail, and we can go on. Even the architecture comes from jail. The need to supervise people in this linear hierarchy comes from jail. The surveying eye, the supervisory eye, comes from the system of prisons. So all of this that I've written here, you know, control and subjugation, isolation of the individual, the hierarchy and the spatial ranking. So the front benchers are smarter, the back benchers are, you know, supposedly poorer. The timetable is a very old inheritance, both from the colonial times as well as from the prison model. The photograph that you see on the top is an old photograph from 1920s or 30s or whatever, probably even earlier. It's not dated really, but this is an old picture, and many of the schools continue to have the same structure. This structure is coming, this is proven historically to come from the prison model. And that is my big question. Should our children, do our children deserve to be in a model that's inspired from that model? Now, even if it's a colonial inheritance, isn't it time that we move away from such models of education? So that is a spirit in which we began this, we started this school 22, 23 years ago in 1998 in Ahmedabad. The idea was that the learning must promote well-being. Well-being is important, not just learning to do, but learning to be and to be well. Now, how do you arrive at that? Because these are large words. So one of the things is, of course, that children must have choice in education, in the classroom processes, in their pedagogy. It can't be a passive one-way thing where the teacher is going on and, you know, you decide everything. The curriculum is given from the top to bottom. Everything is given to the child. The child doesn't have a say. So the fact that children have choices is very important. Choice, what to study, how to study, to contribute with their own ideas. That's very fundamental for well-being. Secondly, to have a purpose, the meaning of it. Why am I doing this thing? Why should I write an essay on cow? Cow is a four-legged animal. Okay, gives us milk, great. You write a nice essay, put it in a file and put it in your drawer. The child knows that this is of no use. It's just an academic arid exercise. But the point is that if the children are involved in meaningful action, action that makes sense to them, action that involves them in decision-making, in contribution to society, in the benefit, you know, for the benefit of others, if there is a meaning to it, and that's also what something that John Dewey, the father of experiential learning, says, the purpose, purposeful education is very important. And as teachers, the first thing you have to ask is, why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? What is the benefit for the children? How is it connected to their life? Is it really important for them to learn this formula right now in the middle of pandemic situation? Is it really important to drown them in Zoom classes, learning meaningless things which don't help them right now? So this connection is not there. The third one is thrive. Now, this is a paradigm shift from the paradigm of survival of the fittest to what I would call the thrival of for all. Because survival of the fittest is a paradigm which is competitive, and it is an exclusionary model. It excludes the others. Whereas thrival for all is a cooperative model, a model based on cooperation of children. And that is an inclusion, you know, it's a model which is inclusive because everybody can work together in a collaborative way and thrive. So that's the model of education we should be going towards. And the final one is Swaraj. Swaraj as in independence, but not independence in the narrow sense of me doing my thing, because the Gandhian idea of Swaraj was self-governance, but with the idea of interdependence. So children have to understand, as much as we do, that the world is an interdependent ecosystem or system. And independence doesn't mean that I can do what I want. It just means whatever I'm doing, is it for the common good of all? So that Swaraj has to have that notion. So these four things is what initially I've noted down. The models that we were inspired by, which have come into our education, but this is by no means only these four, five or six educators. There are more, of course, John Dewey, Piaget. My husband actually was a student of Piaget when he was in college. So his thesis is on Piaget. So there's a lot of developmental stages, etc. All of that has been included. Amongst the Indian educators, definitely Krishnamurti, Aurobindo, Gandhi, of course, and even Tagore. I was not able to put his photograph because I didn't have time and I had to reset it. But please know that even Tagore and Gijubhai Badeka, who comes from Gujarat, wonderful educators. And these are the people who inspired. There are other French educators like Freinet, Celestin Freinet, who did project-based learning, where children actually did a printing press to learn during the Second World War. And that was his way of standing up to a fascist regime. So, you know, these are things that have inspired our education, which is experiential, co-constructivist, co-creative. So what is a paradigm? I'm still trying to set up the framework so you understand the photographs that I'm going to show you shortly. So one thing is that, you know, the past paradigm has been based on fragmentation, knowledge bodies fragmented into small, you know, disciplines, timetable, you know, time cycles fragmented into 1 hour, 35 minute time slots, etc. And the individual students being in just classrooms and not connected to the outside or to themselves. So connection is important. From fragmentation, we need to move to connection. From competition, like I said, we have to meet to cooperation, we have to move to that. And from the repetition of things, this mechanistic way of learning, we have to move towards creation. These three things are really, this process, the shift of paradigm has to have this kind of a shift. All right, now let me tell you about the school. One of the fundamental things about our school is that diversity and inclusion were a very important part of our school. Our school is an international baccalaureate school, but it also has other boards. It has Cambridge, it has, you know, we also offer NIOS. We have other kind of boards. There is the BTEC board, which is very, very creative and very hands-on. And we really love what we're doing with that. But and we are also French board. But the point is not about the boards. The point is the philosophy. And the philosophy of inclusion is that children of all sections should have an access to quality education. So the photograph you see here, before the right to education happened, these are some of the areas from where our children come. And they have studied in our school and they have graduated. So these children are sent to us by the Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation. Now, of course, the idea was diversity and inclusion. We set out with this idea in 1998. And what happened? The Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation said, well, if this is a great project, let's give you a building for it. And when the project happened, a lot of protests broke out. And you can see this destruction of property, bus burning, jail bharo andolan. That's me and my husband many, many years ago, a thinner version of ourselves. And, you know, they went on a rampage. There was a public interest litigation, blood signature campaigns. It went from city to city. It went to the Gujarat High Court. The court ruled in our favor. Then these different lobbies went to the Supreme Court and they lost there as well. And what were the different things they were protesting against? Well, some didn't want an international school, some didn't want an English language. Mainly they said, you cannot mix the rich and the poor because ours is an international school with free education for underprivileged. And the idea was to take charge fees from those who can afford it and to allow different religions, different castes without asking anything about their religion or whatever, just include them. So they said you cannot mix castes in class because you will promote inferiority complex if you are allowing children of different sections of society, socioeconomic sections, to mix together. And that was an argument against which I had no answer except to say that it is a pedagogy that will change it. It is a creative manner, the collaborative ways in which children learn together, where we overcome the walls that are built externally by conditioning. So, the generative resources learning is a pedagogy that is collaborative and co-constructivist, and it's based on, there are no textbooks that we use, identifying real life issues, real life things that children actually solve. It's multisensorial, it's democratic. Children have a say in what they want to learn. We're working with real people in real time, etc. And flexible time. So in the way, so we don't have rules. The children, when they come to class from kindergarten onwards, they decide the rules. And they do their own conflict resolution in Gandhian way. So they decide the rules, then they have to obey the rules. And every 1 day, 10 days, there is a president and secretary by rotation, they pick up children, and they resolve their conflicts in this manner.
Papa ko bata bete.
Oh, I think somebody needs to mute themselves. Yes. Okay, so let me go beyond that. So now you saw that photograph of the seating arrangement, which is front bencher and back benchers. Here you can see that. So our building was a municipal school. Okay, the building that we got from the Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation is a municipal school building. This is a public-private partnership. Ours is not a private school. We decided to do a PPP model by choice and by philosophy. The idea was to join hands and to bring in an alternative mode of education that can benefit municipal school teachers and others. So when we set out to do this, the building was of an existing municipal school that had very few children. And the space is very less. We're in the heart of the city and we are a very small school with very little, very basic infrastructure. So you can see what we did was we needed to use the floor. Since we don't have a lot of outside space, we need to use the floor for a lot of things. So the tables and chairs, the tables go up to the wall and the children sit around every table in different groups and there is no fixed seating arrangement. So this is much more equal. There is no fixed seating. Teacher can access any table, any chair. And for every activity, we mix groups. So children keep moving from one table to another, et cetera. And that's very important even psychologically. The basic premise of our pedagogy is that everything is a resource. And what do we begin with? We begin with the body of the learner. And as a teacher trainer, I used to go to village schools and districts, and I knew what they're going to tell me. They're going to say, oh, ma'am, you're from a big school. Aap to bahut bade koi international school se aa rahe hain. Hamare paas to kuch nahi, hamare paas koi material nahi, hamare paas ye nahi hai, wo nahi hai. And I knew I was ready with that. Haan, lekin aapke paas, you have the body of the learner. Sharir to hai na balak ka. Chalo usi se chalo karte hain. And let's begin and work with the body of the learner, with the space that you have and whatever objects you have in your environment. So that was the basis of this learning pedagogy. Now here, for example, since I'm talking about the body of the learner, here you can see that we are doing a body awareness module. And we always begin with one own self. You know, when we've done reproductive system in, let's say, our own schooling. And I remember reproductive system was a chart paper. It was a small squiggly little diagram in a small textbook. And we never understood what it was all about. You know, it was something very strange and mysterious and probably even boring and shameful, not to forget shameful. So here, the children are, each child is drawing the other's outline on a large sheet of paper. So it's beginning with the own silhouette. As you can see now, the children are drawing the different parts of the body, but it is their own silhouette again. This is not some other external XYZ body of chart paper. And once they've done that, they have made 3D puppets. That means they've made life-size puppets out of cloth and they've stuffed it with waste material or whatever. So they're making puppets. And then I'm also labeling all those different parts of these huge life-size puppets, as you can see. So these are their own silhouettes and own bodies. They're doing their own research. There's no textbook, but there are, of course, resource material that we can use from internet to books in the library or asking people or whatever. And here you can see that they are doing a whole role play. There were lots of games and activities, and the whole project, which ran over several hours and several days, culminates in a role play using the life-size puppets about the body. And that's a lot of fun for children. And by the end of it, they know all the different parts of the body. They know about body awareness, hormonal changes, what happens to them as they grow older, etc. The other thing I was talking to you about is the space. So here you can see that the space is a resource. The children are using the floor space. Then they've drawn the map of the world. They're drawing the map of the world. And you can see here, the map is drawn. And they've used everyday materials to do this. And here, once they've done this, this is already a very big learning for them. Once they've done this, then they pick up chits and they start playing games. So if they pick up a chit and it's run to the Amazon River, then one child will have to run to that and the others will have to say, is it right or wrong? So, start building games. The other games can be eyes closed, in pairs. They walk around and one pair drops off the other into some part of the world and they have to guess where they are, which feature is it. So then they begin to play games for 4 or 5 days and the end of it, they know everything by heart. They are the ones who constructed this. And then they wipe out, they wash it all over. This is just poster paint, people, and ropes. So there's really nothing. So they've learned it all by heart. It is interiorized because different senses have been used. And of course it's fun, you know. I had a big problem because when kids used to go home and typically, you know, parents in India would say, aaj kya sikha? Because you know, they're going to an alternative school. So they're very worried. Are they learning or not? And the kids would say, aaj to khele. Then the next day they'll go back home and say, aaj kya sikha? Aaj bhi khele. So then the parents came to me and said, ma'am, 6 months ho gaye bacche ko rakha aapki school mein. Ab padhana kab chalu karenge? And you know, then I had to start doing workshop with the parents and then they began to understand. So they had to analyze what they'd learn, how they'd learn. It's a game for the children, but the children are actually learning. Here again, the body in space. This is what we call the atom dance. So children are learning the periodic table in chemistry in 9th grade. And they've picked up chits and they have to show the different electrons. They have to show the configuration by dancing. And the dance has to, the choreography has to be related to the nature of that element that they've got. And the other people have to guess it. The other students have to guess it. What is the cost of this? Zero cost. What is the fun element in this? 100%. Kids love it. So they do their music, choreography, dance, whatever you can see. And every batch we do this. And of course, they write the autobiography of element. There are lots of other things. They do experiments as well. But this bringing the body of the learner into education is very important. And this is when you bridge the subject-object dichotomy or the duality which is there. You know, I'm not studying about an atom, I am the atom. And then from the atom, we went on to the molecule dance and they went on working. Here again, different senses, 9th standard children, and they're working with beads. And again, they are guessing. So one child has prepared with the beads, the configuration of an atom. The other child is feeling with the hands and the beads are stuck with tape and they have to feel and guess what is this particular atom. And by that time, you see using a very different sense. And that is how they're learning through their body and senses. Here again, just as an example, daily objects are also a resource. So here they are working with everyday objects, they're analyzing it, etc. I'll come to that. Now, let's talk about the projects. So I'm showing you the pedagogy. And now let me show you what kind of projects do we really do. Here, one of the projects is the cafeteria project. And this is an interdisciplinary project. This has been running in our school from 1999. And in fact, in 2016, Finland made the cafeteria as a compulsory project in primary schools. This is a simple, excellent project to do. You can see your children, you know, we have very simple resources. We are not a rich school in that sense of the word. So here you can see children are making nimbupani. And by making nimbupani, they're putting sugar and salt and water. They're learning binomials, polynomials, they're doing equations, they're tasting it. On the left-hand corner, you can see that they made a chart paper and they're actually analyzing what are they really eating at home? What are they bringing in the tiffin boxes? So the symbols stand for, you know, triangle. They decide a triangle, a circle for carbohydrates or this or that, whatever. And by analyzing what they're eating, they come to the conclusion that, all right, maybe my meal is not balanced. And what do we really need to eat in order to have a balanced meal? From there, from all the research then, from asking grandparents to sourcing recipes, they decide on recipes, they conduct surveys, they finally decide on a recipe that they're going to make for any other class. And then they decide, they calculate the volume, the proportion of food, the costing, everything. They go outside, they make the purchases, they make the food, and they serve the food. And in such a project, then what we are doing is we are relating, we're linking culture, food, hygiene, science, communication, menu cards, language, mathematics. All of these things are organically just falling into the project. So what we are doing is we're not starting with the concept at all. We're not starting with content. Ki aaj kya karana hai? Mujhe fractions sikhane. No, fractions will fall in naturally wherever you're connected with real life. What's the real life project that I'm doing? So children don't run the cafe every day. They might run the cafe once in a month. But in order to do that, they're doing a lot of things. And each subgroup is doing a different role each time. So the subgroup that is handling accounts. So one group handles accounts. One is handling cooking, one is handling purchases, etc. One is handling communication, serving, whatever. And then they swap their roles. The other kind of projects you can see is a waste management project, a very important project again. in our current times, you know. And here again, beginning with the child's own context. So children are told, what is it that you're consuming over a period of time? Let's say 1 week. And then they gather all the boxes or whatever packaging of whatever they've consumed, and they get that to school. And once they get it to school, they begin to classify it. So you can see that they've begun to classify. Is it biodegradable, not biodegradable? What is it made of, etc.? And how much does it weigh? Whatever I'm consuming, what's the weight of the packaging? And from there, they begin to understand about consumption patterns. They're also analyzing the packaging itself. What are the ingredients that I'm eating? You know, what am I consuming? Into what's going into my body? What does added color and preservatives mean? Okay, what does MRP mean? And is this weight actually including the weight of the packaging or not? And then they also do surveys or analysis of what is made locally and what is imported from another country, global and local. They make an analysis of what are my needs and what are my wants. And that is amazing. If human beings can come to the idea and analyze that, what do I really need to live happily? And what am I being manipulated to purchase more and more of? Then I think things would become so much. And children are very, very, aware of doing these things. So here they've analyzed the needs and wants. And then they create an awareness campaign with other children saying that, wait a minute, before you buy that packet of biscuit, just be aware, how much of packaging are we really throwing into the nature again? So of course, then they do integrated arts, they do awareness campaign, means posters, it means a lot of other things that they are doing around it, of course. And they also redesigned their own eco-friendly packaging after that. But I'm not showing you all the pictures, we don't have time. Now, this means that the teachers in our school have to map a project. So here, for example, is creating a waste management solution is the project. And we are mapping not the content, we are mapping the processes. What does this entail? And in the processes, so I'm designing an eco-friendly container. If I'm doing that, then we have to analyze the boxes collected. We are learning ratio proportion. We are researching between surface and volume. So automatically, once you map the processes, the content is just going to naturally fall in. Every subject teacher knows what content I can bring in. Similarly, running the campaign, what does it mean? What are the different processes? And that is how the children are learning the content as well. And you can see in this little map, all the words are ing, ending in present continuous. They're verbs. So it's calculating, identifying, making, taking, running, conducting, researching, etc. These are action verbs. If you have action verbs, the children are going to be doing something. We don't want just abstract concepts there. Otherwise, we'll fall into topics. And believe me, a project is not a topic. Water is a topic, it's not a project. Yes, doing rainwater harvesting for your school is a project because you're doing something. There's an outcome. But if I just do water, it'll remain as abstract and as sometimes even boring. Okay, so the other kind of projects, multimedia. So, you know, earlier on, cameras were expensive. Today, it's so much easier. So our children make films, social films, you know, films on social issues of their own choice. And there you can see that they're doing their own script writing. So language comes in. There is physics with the lighting. There's technology. They're doing their own editing, etc. And this becomes a whole design cycle, and they write the report about it. So we're connecting humanities, science, language, even ethics, because when you're filming, the amount of permissions that you require, you know, all those things come together. And in fact, just to add to that, these children have been also bidding and making films for professionals. So that's the level that kids can actually go up to. These are the kind of very big mappings that are done, making a film. Now, I can't go, that's a whole separate session, but I'm just showing you so you can see as I'm zooming in into one aspect of that mapping, and you can see here editing, just the editing or scripting has so many different stages, from storyboarding, editing, studying other scripts, expressing what learners want to tell. They're doing role plays, analyzing, all these things. So lots of things are there. So here to give you an example from the filmmaking, the children participated in a voter awareness program for the Election Commission of India. And they made even posters, jingles, all kinds of things for the Election Commission as a pilot project. And these 25 children made these voter awareness pledges, which is made in local language. So that's how you're getting the local language in. Language is always in context. Language is not a separate standalone thing only. So here they've done that. And this went to 75 lakh people in Gujarat, where they signed the water pledge, returned it back to the government. So, you know, the citizenship that they're talking about, and this is something I told Election Commission years ago when I was a civil society member giving in, feedback, and that time Mr. Qureshi was the CEO, and I said, how do you expect young people to vote if they have no experience of what does it mean? You know, how important is my voice? If schools don't become democratic institutions, if we don't involve children in citizenship, they will not understand when they come out of school how important is their vote. So these are the things that are important to do. And of course, this project got us a lovely award from the school, a lovely award from the former president. So that's a proud moment. Now, of course, I'm talking about pedagogy, and I know that one question in your minds would be, what about assessment? And very quickly, we don't talk about examinations. We are talking about giving value to what children know. So here, this is a political party that children made because elections were going on in Gujarat also. And the child, let's say the exam, if you want to call it, but the assessment was that they have to write a manifesto and give the manifesto to the rest of us. And we are going to assess and give feedback according to the criteria and the rubrics. So for that, they had art because they had to make their own posters, they ran their own political campaigns, and they wrote their manifesto on an issue of their choice in the language of their choice. So this is all of us giving feedback. Incidentally, this young gentleman that you see who's speaking has just finished his PhD in the same field. He studied the election processes in UP, in the University of Rochester, and he's got a gold medal for his dissertation. So that's how projects can be very meaningful to children to find their calling. These are the kind of report cards that we make. This, again, it's a 30-page report card sometimes, so I'm not going to go into details, but to give you an idea that the reporting itself is a link, using self-evaluation, peer feedback, and parental feedback and a teacher synthesis. And then we're looking at what the children have done inside a project, and inside that project, which are the different disciplines they did, and inside the discipline, what are the different competencies that were done. But we are using a variety of things to bring in the evaluation. And you can see here, for example, the task in this grade 4 or 5 is make a brochure about your trip outside. So the brochure making is the assessment task, and the criteria also co-constructed with the children. And here the peer feedback is so nicely done. You can see that the children have learned how to give feedback. Peer feedback won't happen on its own. It's a learning process also. So headings are well done. You've colored them and outlined them. It makes them stand out very well. Your handwriting has improved, but it's not in a straight line in some places, too close together. I really like the manner in which you've expressed yourself. It is detailed, interesting, personal, has your feelings, etc. I think you did a great job. Your brochure design is very unique. So look at the way the peers are giving validating feedback and constructive feedback to the others. And they're happy, and they've done the brochure by hand, by the way, encouraging them to draw and do it. So a lot of things can go into that. At a higher class, now you're going to say, what about higher classes? All this is okay, primary mein hota hai, but like in higher class mein toh karna padta, it's very subject driven. But here also, this is 10th grade, and this is an interdisciplinary task between sciences and physical education. And this student, what was the task? To design, explain, and justify a plan to improve your cardiovascular fitness routine. And it was a 2-week assessment, and the children do it on their own, and they send that report is what is assessed. Right, so you can see the sciences criteria is there and physical criteria is there. So you can see all the criteria, the initiator. So that's one word which is new maybe for you. So years ago when we started our school, we struggled with the idea of teacher. I didn't like the word teacher, and teacher has a very didactic ring to it. As I'm teaching something, I'm not teaching, but you're all here to learn. So finally we decided what word. Facilitator was very corporate kind of a word. So finally we decided initiator, because what I'm doing is I'm initiating the group into learning, and I'm part of this group, and that's it. All my role is only to initiate them. And then the group has its own energy and they carry on. So here you can see self-reflection, child has written that, there's a peer feedback, and I'm skipping a lot of other pages, that's another session. All right, so that's just a global view of our pedagogy. What does it mean? Children have done very well. You can see Chandrika came from the municipal school to our school. She has struggled a lot against a lot of difficult socioeconomic challenges, and she's now an independent filmmaker today, having done graduated from a school. Johan came from another school. He had a lot of dyslexia. He was not comfortable with reading. He was not reading and writing at all. And he joined us pretty late in seventh grade. But then we managed to connect with him. He found his passion in music. And through music, he learned poetry. We did rhythm, mathematics, history, all these things related to music. And today he's a very successful musician in Bollywood. He's also come in a lot of films in Bollywood. So these are some of the success stories. Now let me come back as I head towards the ending of my presentation. Let me now come, we did a lot of work with the body and the five senses. And then in 2014, like I said, we lost our daughter Tara, and that's Tara at the age of 12. And it was a sudden departure. She had an infection and she suddenly left this world. And we began to find her notes later on, like I said, her poetries, messages. And one thing that struck was, so she always told us that I am not interested in growing older. I don't want to be a teenager. And I one day asked her, why do you keep saying you don't want to grow older? And she said, I don't want to leave you. I don't want to go away. I don't want to leave. And I couldn't understand what was she talking about. I thought she's talking about going to university or something. She's scared about her body changing. But later on, I began to understand that there was something much more than just the five senses. And we began to explore the role of intuition. And as we began to explore that, because I began to get messages, I began to become more intuitive, I began to connect with my subconscious, the dreams, and we understood that in order to arrive at those three things that I spoke to you about in the beginning of my presentation, which is connection, cooperation, and creativity, you need intuition to be able to make a connection. You need intention in order to be able to arrive at cooperation. And you need imagination in order to arrive at creativity. These are the three fundamental stones, stepping stones that are going to allow us to arrive at that goal. Now, intuition, you are all teachers. And future teachers or existing teachers, you and even parents, you know that there is no formula for one child. You know that even as a parent between two children, what works with one child will not work with the other. And at that point in your classroom, when one child is, let's say, misbehaving or is distracted or is not listening to you, you have to have different strategies for different children. For one children, you will need to push the child a little more. And to the other child, you'll have to say, well done, it's fine, it's okay, because this child is very fragile. So where does that answer come from to deal with children? That comes from intuition. That comes from your inner gut feeling. And this intuition is so important. You know, people who are in the police work, who are detectives, they also find things through intuition. Read the reports of firefighters. Firefighters, when they go into a building that has fire, don't know where to go because they just get a feeling that they have to go into this place, and very often the intuition is right. So intuition is more than just a survival instinct. It's a guiding, it's a compass. And that is something which has been so neglected in our school education. So based on all of that, and I'm not talking about all woo-woo stuff. What I'm talking about is developing based on the new scientific discoveries. I'm not talking about just using anything out of the blue. So who are the scientists? Well, I've given you some examples. Rupert Sheldrake, Amit Goswami, Gary Zukav, Joe Dispenza. And my idea is to bring in a consciousness curriculum that is based on quantum physics, epigenetics, all the new things which are making connections between science and spirituality. So based on that, we did one amazing experiment. So please go on the YouTube and you'll find this. This is called the rice experiment. And this was a Japanese scientist called Masaru Emoto. And Emoto has written this book about messages from water. You know, he took water, polluted water from the Fujiwara Dam. And then he froze the water molecules and examined the water molecules. And it was a very disparate structure. The molecular structure did not look coherent at all. And then he had some Buddhist monks come and pray. And then he examined the same water again. And the water had a coherent structure, the molecular structure. So he began to explore, do our thoughts, feelings, and what we tell water change the structure of water? Does it shift? Does it impact the molecules? And if it does, then that means that our consciousness, our thought processes, our emotions and feelings can have an impact on matter. So he did another thing called rice experiment. And if you go on YouTube, you'll find that. And on the rice experiment, they took rice in three beakers. To one, the experimenter gave positive feelings like "I love you." To the other, the experimenter called it an idiot. And the third jar, the experimenter ignored. They did this for 1 month. And after 1 month, they found that the jar that was loved was fermenting properly. The water was white. The rice was in perfect condition. The jar that was bullied or harassed or whatever, you know, scolded, was rotting. And the one that was ignored, the third jar, which was ignored, was completely rotten. And this was tremendous. So we also did the same experiment. And here you can see KG children have done this experiment in our school. And you can see that on YouTube. The film is called MGS, Mind Over Matter. Now, this means many, many things, both in terms of science and other things. The point is not for me to say, oh, well, you know, do this and see you're going to succeed. No, you may or may not succeed in this experiment. But the point is we need to be breaking the ceiling in the kind of experiments we do in our schools, which are bringing in, you know, another dimension to our learning. So this is what we did. And our results were the same as Emoto. And this has a very important impact. You see, we are made up of 70% water. So if your thoughts can impact, positive thoughts can impact something outside, your thoughts are also impacting your own body. Okay, that's the fundamental learning. And this learning, if we can learn in school, then we will lead much more self-aware kind of lives. And that was, and of course, the other thing for education, this kind of experiment, the jar that is loved, the rice prospered. In our experiment, the jar that was given a negative feeling, there were worms, but they died. You know, there were no worms. And the third one, which was just cursed, you know, just ignored, that had also totally no life in it. Which means in your classroom, the child that is given attention will blossom. The child who's ignored, the soul of this child will almost die. So ignoring somebody is the worst form of violence that you can do. And sometimes educators, parents, they say, "Maine kya bola? Main to maine bola hi nahi kuch usko." Yeah, you didn't say anything, but your ignorance, you're shutting yourself off from this child, shutting communication is a terrific act of violence. So to ignore somebody is to negate that person's existence. And that is very, very important, as a lesson. So that's the rice experiment. Let me go to the... Yeah, so after that, we started doing lots of, you know, teacher trainings. You can see we're using the whole body. They all become part of a tree. They're breathing together. They're touching a tree and they're getting some answers from the tree. They're asking questions to the tree. And this is already intuitive. We did psychometry. Psychometry is reading objects and getting information from objects, from people you don't know. You don't know about the object, but you can glean information. So this is, again, like remote viewing. It's like opening up your third eye. And here children are learning to use energy, and they're learning to use intuition to even decide for their careers. So, you know, a lot of adolescents or end of schooling, they're going to say, "I don't know what to do with my life." Everybody says, "Doctor bano, ye karo, wo karo." But your intuition, your own compass, if you don't access that, you might end up making the wrong choice. So as much as the rational part of our decision-making is very important, the rational brain is so important because it gives us also a path to walk on. The intuitive part is also equally important. Both have to be given importance. Just a little quote from one of my students. I'll let you to read that. But what I like about this quote is that in the last end, he says, "MGS is where you can be you and be a part of something bigger." And I really like that, because the idea is to find your place in life, find your place in the cosmic scheme of things, find your place in human society. And you have to be really you, but you also have to know that I am interconnected. I'm part of something much larger than myself. It's not just about your own ego. So I think that I really like this little feedback from the student. We asked our students what the purpose of learning. I don't have to go into all these things because you already know yourself that these are the important things in learning. It's not about the formula. It's about solving problems. It's about being confident. It's about being inquisitive, learning to learn, and making a real difference in the world. So now, from that time, after we lost Tara, I both of us threw ourselves back into work. We began to work on intuition and other things. And now we are giving conferences and workshops the world over, Geneva and Paris and Moscow and everywhere. I'm ending my presentation today, and that's perfect time. I'm ending my presentation again. One of the poems by Farah. And this is a poem that she's written again when she must have been 9 or 10. The world, they say, the world, they said. The world is a big place and I'm small, but I matter because I am matter. And I think this message coming from Tara, and that's probably what she wants me to continue to tell in the work that I do. My conferences or presentations are not about my message only. This is also a message coming from her through me. And I think that's what she wants to tell everybody. Every child matters. And Tara had a very happy childhood. We don't know about the amount of time we are going to be on this planet, but whatever time we have, at least we as educators must ensure that all that we do with our children leads them to discover who they are and find their place in the world and have a happy childhood so that there is resilience. And as they grow older, they find their place in society. And that's the most important thing. That's what gives us resilience. That's what gives us life purpose. That is what gives meaning to our life. And that is what really I think we're here for. So thank you very much for this, for being patient listeners. And that's our website. And today the movement that we've started is called École de Tara. This is in France as well. That's where the French name, but École is school, but it's a school of thought. It's not really a physical school. And the idea is to have joyful experiential learning for a sustainable future and a harmonious self. Thank you. And I'm going to stop sharing. And yes.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you so much, Anju Chezo, if I'm right in pronouncing your word. Yeah, so Dr. Anju, it was really lots of ideas which can be implemented in the classrooms and really heartfelt poems by your daughter. It was really rare gems that you shared with us, and we are very thankful for that. And so there are lots of questions on the chat itself. And if participants want to unmute and speak up and ask questions, that is also okay. So, and before even we do that, let's give Shalini a chance to summarize it in Hindi in a few lines, if you can, Shalini. Make an attempt, whatever it is like. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am, I can summarize. So I think there were many questions when the workshop was going on. And maybe if the participants are not able to unmute and share, if I can share with the speaker. Is it okay, ma'am? Ruchi, ma'am?
Yeah, that is fine. That is fine.
Yeah. So I think there were what were very clear from the chat talks. It was clear some of the questions were more about the community involvement. That how the parents of the children are involved in the process. This is exactly what you mentioned, that how you were facing challenges when you were trying to connect with the children and then you try to take some workshop of the parents. So could you share a bit, a brief, what type of interaction you often have with the parents? It will be helpful for the teachers. The second question or other questions pattern was more around, I think the kind of teachers training. What kind of, who actually are teachers in your school? And what are the initial teachers, professional development type of training often used to take place? So if you could talk more, a little bit in this, then I would be able to summarize in a more detail, ma'am.
Okay, so it's difficult.
Yeah.
See, the kind of curriculum you have need really good professional development training from the teacher's point of view.
Yeah.
Also, there were questions about assessment. Seems as if you have a lot of formative assessment. So whether you have summative assessment or not, and how do you manage that in the schools itself? Yeah. Any other questions, Shalini? But I think let's give these three. You respond to this and we'll have a look at others.
So there was one more question, which I think I find personally is very important. The kind of board which is in your school is different than the rest of the board from where the most of the teachers come, CBSE and ICSE. And curriculum has a very important role to play, especially for a teaching to happen. So even being in a particular board, whether it's a CBSE, ICSE, this is what I remember when you're talking about intuition and cooperation and creativity. So I think creativity can be possible through cooperation and interaction and discussion. This is what we are doing. But when we talk about creation and when we talk about cooperation, I think curriculum play an important role. So even if the kind of curriculum which is there in your school is not there in other teachers' school, what kind of, how they can really learn from this pedagogy and use in their classroom?
Let me first respond to the questions in order. One is about parents. The parents, you see, initially, parents are very skeptical. And when we started the school, they were absolutely frightened almost of the kind of things we were doing. And that's why when we did what we do with teachers, which is that we made them go through the same exercises that the children did, and then we made the parents analyze, what do you think you've learned out of this? And that is how the parents began to understand that what we were doing was not just about, you know, fun and games only. There was a lot of thought that went into it. And for me, pedagogy is really an art, you know, it's an artistic process. Everything has to be, activities have to flow. We have to think about how we're doing things. And once we began to do that, parents began to get convinced. Our PTMs, you know, the parent-teacher meetings, earlier on, we used to be explaining, and sometimes parents can become in a little bit of an attacking mode, and you know, you feel defensive, and teachers feel very different because already they're struggling to do all of this and they have to answer. But then we found the perfect solution. Our children run the PTMs. So the children decide what are they going to showcase to the parents. They know the questions that the parents are anyway going to ask them because they ask them at home. And they make the parents do the activities, and then they ask the parents to analyze, and the teacher does nothing, but she plans with the kids beforehand. So these are some of the things that have happened. And in fact, now parents don't come to a school for PTMs. They're saying, sab samajh mein aa gaya hai. So that's, you know, just a side show. But yeah, you have to involve the parents. It's very important. And I'll tell you one thing. There have been parents who have not understood. I mean, everybody doesn't understand. They're coming from a different space maybe. But, you know, one thing that the parents do see is that their children are happy. And what they do see, that a shy child became super confident. A child with psychosomatic disorders brought to the school, the disorders went away in 1 week. So these are the things that parents can understand. So they tell themselves, all right, maybe we don't understand everything, but our child is thriving, and that's a good starting point for them. So that was the first thing. Now, of course, the teacher training. The second question was related to that. When we started the school, we decided, there's some nice musical background, music score. I think that's Swati. Yeah, thank you. Though I don't mind the sound effects, but maybe the others, I don't know if they can hear me. Okay, so the teacher training, when we started the school, we didn't look at B.Eds. And I mean, it's nice to have that too, but we really looked at the passion that people had. And we got people, like we got young people. Somebody said, you know, I'm a fashion designer, but I love kids and I really want to work. I said, all right, come on, join the ship, you know. And that's how. So there were teachers who would come. Frankly, I'll tell you, I shouldn't say this, but I'm talking about 22 years back, okay? Now what you're doing with this and in the new courses are different. But sometimes it's more difficult to make teachers unlearn what they've learned than, you know, to learn something new. So we thought we must do a lot of teacher trainings. And Pascal and I, my husband, are teacher trainers. That's our main work. So we did a lot of teacher training. Now, the point about teacher training is it has to be experiential. And if it is not, if the teacher doesn't undergo a transformative process, don't expect it to happen in the classroom. So all these things, so we do the teacher trainings here. And it is not just that it is driven by one or two people. It's the whole faculty. We used to test our ideas. You know, every teacher would come and say, all right. And all of us were like a class group. And we would allow the teacher to run her thing and then say, you know what, that worked and that didn't work. This was odd. And that's how we kind of gave confidence to each other and honest feedback. So teacher training continues to be important. And that's one of the very important parts of our project. The third thing you're talking about, assessment. Of course, there's summative assessment and there is formative is throughout the year. The International Baccalaureate is a tough board. And now we've launched the International Baccalaureate Career Program. But our children also appeared for the state board when it was a new school. And we still did things in a fun way. So summative assessments are there. We have to prepare them. And we do that also in a fun way. Children prepare their own assessments also. And they give to, you know, one group gives, carries it out for the others. Then one group, and they do their own marking. So we do that. Now, let me tell you this, that ultimately what is important is the grade 12, the last year of the school is important because that exam is your passport to the university, not your 7th standard exam, not your 8th standard exam, not your 5th or 6th standard exam. That is nothing. That's internal. So what we really focused on were all the skills, and of course we give them practice. And by the time they come into the last couple of years, they are so good in being able to do research, being able to write, being able to think. So then it's just preparing for the exam, you know, and that's what they do. They do prepare for the exams very rigorously and they clear them with very, very good grades. There are some, most of our students are in the top universities of the world, whether they're in the country or elsewhere. So yeah, and how do we cover the curriculum of the board? You know, today, even with the NCRT, this is a competency-based curriculum. What we do is we map a project. Inside the project, what are the disciplines I can touch? So inside the cafeteria, I gave you the example that, you know, we have mathematics. In mathematics, what are the different things that the child can do in, let's say, overall? And then we will plan it out. So there will be fractions, there will be profit and loss, there will be volume, there will be ratio, there will be proportion. A lot of mathematical concepts will come in. So the teacher knows that when we are doing these projects, this is how I'll be doing things while the children are doing. We don't go from abstract to concrete. We go in the Piagetian sense from concrete to abstract. After the kids have done and while they're doing it, then the theory starts coming in. And it's easy to put the words, the definitions make sense because children know they've done the thing. So they understand what it means. Though otherwise, if you're going to start with definitions and things, this is meta language. Definition is a meta language. And children are going to get more confused with language. They already are grappling with basic concepts in language. But when they're doing things and they experience things, then in the real action, they know what it means in their head. And then giving some words and theory is a different thing. So the curriculum is very, very, detailed. It's a tough curriculum we have to do. We have to do things like theory of knowledge, you know, which is epistemology in grade 11 and 12. They have to do a thesis at the end of grade 12. At the end of grade 10, they have all the 8 subjects and they have to present a portfolio. I mean, there are lots of things that they're doing. So for CBSE and ICSE schools, since I'm working with them, the point is to move away from the textbooks and to actually ensure that the competencies are done, whatever are the learning outcomes and competencies. And when you map a project, a good many competencies come in. I'm not saying they're going to come in all the projects. Maybe in a year, I'll do 3 projects. Okay, the rest I can do as a standalone module. For example, I want them to understand poetry, okay, metaphor and whatever in poems. I can do painting and poetry together. So I did the free verse, Margaret Atwood, surrealism, Dali, all together with music. I can do one module like that. Maybe it's not a huge project, but it's a small thing. And they did haiku poems along with that. So, you know, things like that, you can connect, make small modules, but it has to be experiential. It has to be joyful. And I'll tell you one thing, the feedback from our kids, they don't need to learn by rote. They know it. And when our children went to the big colleges in the country, they went to, you know, school of, you know, in Hyderabad or Bangalore or Bombay or whatever, even when they went, you know, LSR or, you know, in London or whatever, they didn't need to learn any definitions, for example, in economics by heart. The jury throws a question, they know the answer in their own words, they're able to express because they've understood in depth what it means. So our children have run free markets, they've done community drives, but whatever they've done it. We have not taught them anything. And I want to just end with one particular interesting, you know, anecdote. So when I was 20 years back when the school was new, my mother went to a party, okay? I mean, some social gathering. And they told her, "Acha, your daughter runs that Mahatma Gandhi International School. That's a school where they don't teach anything, na?" And she came and told me that. She says, "That's what they're saying." And I felt so bad. "Kya bole? Ye kuch padhate nahi hai. They don't teach anything." I really cried that night. I mean, it was really bad. And the next morning I got up and saying, "Hey, Eureka, it's true we don't teach them anything because children learn. They're learning. We're not teaching them. They're learning. And that's the paradigm shift, to create opportunities for children to learn, not to teach them anything. Because teaching, you will kill it. You will just destroy it. You know, I keep saying, you want to kill something, make it a subject and putting it in a school, and you finished it. Rather than that, just creating opportunities for children to learn and to connect with their passion, you know, what they enjoy. So in our school, the children are also voting for projects. So this is just some of the things. I mean, there's a lot to share. This is just a very short session, but I hope I've answered most of your queries.
Yes, yes. I think, ma'am, most of the questions you have answered. Thank you so much for all this learning. It was a wonderful session for every one of us, I'm sure. And I think I can see chat full of thank you, ma'am. It was a beautiful session. And I request participants, if you have any other question, please fill up the form and you could comment, and if we could post your questions over there, we will look forward what we could do. So yeah, I think I could summarize the workshop, and for the participants who joined late, it will be a great learning for them also, even at the end. So I think if I go in Hindi, I will try not to be completely in Hindi, but it will be English. But at the end, it matters understanding, you know. So sabse pehle hum sabhi teachers ke liye, हम सभी टीचर्स एक अलग अलग बैकग्राउंड से आते हैं. हम सभी टीचर्स कोई CBSE हैं, कोई ICSE हैं, और कहीं ना कहीं हम टेक्स्ट बुक से बंधे हुए हैं. लेकिन इसके बीच भी हम अपनी क्रिएटिविटी को अपने क्लासरूम में अवश्य सामने ला सकते हैं. और उसके लिए ज़रूरी है कि हम केवल कुछ बच्चों के लिए ना सोचकर सभी के लिए सोचें. इसी को इंक्लूजन कहा जाता है, जहाँ पे एक टीचर्स डज नॉट थिंक ओनली फॉर अ स्टूडेंट बट फॉर ऑल द क्लासमेट्स, फॉर ऑल द चाइल्ड. और जब आप ये फिलॉसफी अपने अंदर एक लाते हैं कि हम सभी के लिए काम कर रहे हैं, सभी हमारे बच्चे, तो कहीं ना कहीं आपके अंदर वो इंट्यूशन जो एट द एंड मैम ने कहा कि वो एक खुद के अंदर एक दृढ़ निश्चय आता है कि हम कैसे अपनी पेडागॉजी को ज़्यादा क्रिएटिव बना सकते हैं, इमेजिनेटिव बना सकते हैं, जहाँ बच्चा केवल रोट लर्निंग से हटकर वो इमेजिनेशन या खुद की ओन डिस्कवरी में एंटर कर सके, खुद को खोजे. तो उसके लिए टीचर का क्लासरूम में उतना ही पार्टिसिपेशन ज़रूरी है जितना बच्चों का. सो आई थिंक फॉर द थ्री रूल्स विच यू शेयर्ड, इट वॉज अ क्रिएशन, कॉपरेशन एंड क्रिएटिविटी. और डॉक्टर मैम, डॉक्टर अंजू ने एक टेड टॉक भी है, अगर आप लोग को और इस थ्री फिलॉसफी के की एलिमेंट्स के बारे में जानना है तो आप टेड टॉक भी देख सकते हैं. सो आई थिंक नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट रुचि मैम टू प्लीज शेयर हर थॉट एट द एंड, एंड थैंक यू एवरीवन.
Just somebody has put a question about how are they learning binomials and polynomials in the... So I'm just responding to that. There are two variables. So they're learning with variables, you know, sugar and lemon or salt or water, whatever. So they look at the variables and they change the variables and they explore that. I mean, there are lots of things we can... Well, you can always write to me. I'm anju@mgis.in. And if there are queries, I can always answer.
Ma'am, could you share some of the, like, your learning, your resource, from where they could get some resource material, the teachers, if they want to refer?
Yeah, that would be nice.
Dr. Ruchi, already, I think we can direct them to Diksha because there's already work done with this.
Yes.
And then if there's extra stuff, I'm hoping we'll be able to create a platform and share.
Yeah. So myself, Anju, and a few people from TIS faculty, they are working on this course called Experiential Learning. And we hope that we will be able to bring this course out to all of you in a few months or in some time. So just hold on. And we already, I think there is already a course on Diksha on experiential learning. And I will share that link in the Telegram group. You can have a look at that. And yeah, so, and the recording also we will share on the Telegram group itself. I'm sorry, I had a bit of an issue at that time with my laptop. Somehow it was lagging a lot and I was not able to unmute. But I really want to thank you, Dr. Anju, for coming here and sharing all these ideas with us. It was really a very enriching experience, and to share your opinions with all of us and to share a few experiences that you have, the way you have worked with the students. People, and it's nice to see that people are willing to try it out, even though they understand the challenges that they might be in their own situations where they are bound by the boards or the curriculum or the management. But even if you take up a few of these ideas and try to implement in the classrooms, I think it will be really nice. And I really love the idea of mapping out a particular activity in terms of different subjects and the processes and the concepts that can be dealt with it, looking at the various activities that one is doing. So I think that is an idea that is really worth trying out to do interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary learning in your own classroom. So yeah, thanks a lot, Dr. Anju. So I just request people to just stay back for 5 more minutes if they can, because I want to share announcement for a few courses. And the link for the Telegram group has been shared in the chat. Shalini, you can share that again. Yeah, you can
leave everyone. Anju. Thank you very much. You can explore on mgis.in, our website, and also CBSE experiential learning webinars that were done with Tata and Tata Trusts and TIS. They are also online on YouTube. I'll send a link to Ruchi, and that can be shared with everyone.
Yes.
And the mapping activities are there. Okay, bye everyone. Thank you, and wish you all the best.